it's clear that in terms of optimistic positivity as a predictor of mortality, it does predict mortality, and it predicts mortality when you control for lots of different self-reported health problems, depression scales that have been validated, self-reported health. If you're interested in predicting things from optimism, optimistic positivity, you want to look at what predicts it. And that's what I was focusing on in that first paper. So we have three papers already started. Basically, we're looking at explicit measures of optimism, as well as these, what we're using wording effects to measure what we're calling implicit measures of close to perceptual optimism and pessimism. That positive wording bias is a form of optimism. But if you're looking at the world in more positive ways, you're taking information in, and you're framing it in positive ways, and you're seeing it, so you're reacting to it in positive ways, sometimes in the way that you don't even know that you're doing, right? It's so subtle, it's like a wording effect that you couldn't say that it's not like I'm asking you, are you responding this way to these words or that, those ways to that words? We can detect it statistically over people. So when you're asking people to say things about themselves on a survey, for example, you're asking them, are you a good person? Are you a competent person? There's a whole series of questions you can ask them. Some of them are worded positively, some of them are negatively. And usually those wording, those survey questions are used to create scales of things like self-esteem, self-efficacy, mastery. There's a latent variable. The idea is that there's something out there, it's latent, and it explains some variance in how people answer these questions. We're putting that together with some measures that ask people about how optimistic they are, using language explicitly, and saying that together those things create this phenomena, and we're saying that the phenomena goes deep to the level of perception. Is it itself a form of stratification? Is there something about optimism that's a resource that we can understand as a psychological good, like happiness, right? And so if it's stratified in a population, how is it associated with other kinds of stratification? Income and so forth, education. And so, you're saying, well, class, the real interesting one is class, right? Everybody wants to know, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, think positively, you'll be successful. If you're optimistic, you'll be successful, right? But of course, if you're successful, you're gonna be optimistic. So there's the reverse causality thing, and so taking out class and looking at class is really the really interesting part of that I want to get to, right? And I think that's an interesting question because there's a lot of theory around sociology and emotions, around the idea that expectations are created, the ability to meet expectations generates energy, that energy is what allows people to do things, it's that emotional energy. And then it replicates itself. So people are convinced to be optimistic, especially the middle classes. And if they're not able to achieve those expectations, then that their energy goes down and they become dissatisfied. There's some difference with cohorts. And now I see with race difference, I see cohort differences when you were born. And that makes sense in terms of things like the civil rights movement and what you experienced in your life, right? And your hopes and dreams and so forth. So the question I'm looking at now, first, of course, is, well, you can't change, there's not much way that your optimism, your pessimism is gonna change your gender in a statistically significant way. Might change it. People can change their gender. But it's not gonna change your age, it's not gonna change your birth cohort, and race, very small effects. So I'm looking at those things that influence, that can be understood as causes of, and they can't be reverse causality first. So that's what I've been doing. And we ran these models, and what do we see? Well, we saw that when you look at all these things, race, birth cohort, age, and gender together, that there's these curves, and the curves are interesting. They start off with men being more optimistic than women. There's a convergence in midlife, and then a divergence again where men are more higher optimistic positivity than women, right? We see a race trends, and those vary by cohort. People born before 1932, whites are more optimistic than blacks. For all these people, optimistic positivity declines with age, right? So we're seeing these trends over time declining with age. But whites are more optimistic than blacks, and it's declining. But for people born after 1932, we see blacks having higher levels of optimistic positivity. These Americans, right, all U.S. data, higher levels of optimistic positivity than whites over the age period. They're still declining time. That's optimistic positivity. What about pessimistic negativity, right? Blacks consistently higher than whites in this pessimistic negativity across cohorts. So we can look at those things and say, you know, people who got more schooling past high school, you know, they were optimistic when we first measured them, and they were more likely to get some schooling, and we can try to control for other things and say it's really the optimism that's influencing the schooling. We could also try to say, you know, their class background is influencing their optimism and pessimism. And I think we're in a better position to say something about that. We can look at them over 25 years. We don't have what you were born with, right? We don't have when you started off with, right? We do have what income your parents made, you know, what school you know, how much schooling you got, and so forth. I was thinking about this was that I really came of age. I graduated high school in 1976. Those Great Society programs were in place. There was really opportunity for people who I went to Somerville High. At that time, it was called Slumerville. You know, it wasn't very. It's a place now that's very. Houses worth millions of dollars and so forth. But at that time, it was a working class neighborhood. I wasn't a great student. I got into university. I did well in university because the only option I saw was joining the Air Force or the Army. And now I'm a professor, right? So I was thinking about my career in terms of this project and the opportunities I've had. And I mean, I'm a pessimistic person, but I took advantage of the opportunities because I saw that there were doors. The way society is structured is that there's doors, and if you can jump through them, it doesn't really matter what your skill is that much. Their divisions are fine-grained, and if you can get through that door, you get all sorts of resources, and then you're going to get to the next level. So I became optimistic about academia in a way that allowed me to continue. Put my nose to the grindstone and not to think too much about it because the resources were there, right? I made the decision. Yeah, I mean, but really the point I wanted to make was these policies, these programs, kids don't have them anymore. Like now, I teach, and the kids see that the middle is getting hollowed out, right? And they're anxious. Mental health problems in university have gone through the roof, right? And universities don't know how to deal with it. And I can see why they have, because the opportunities aren't there and the kids realize that there's a bifurcation, right? There's a make it or break it. I look at myself, I look at my own history, and I say I was the tail end of the baby boom, and you know, I profited economically, in some ways, socially in some ways, but you know, in other ways, maybe not. And so I look at these generational differences now, and I can understand now you're going back to business, right, going in. Somebody gets a job in the gig economy, right? What's their mentality like? There's another gig down the road. I'll make it work to the extent I can, or has it become like, this has to really work, and if it doesn't work, I'm screwed, right? My career, I don't really know. I don't think anybody really knows what's happening in these areas that you're interested in terms of work, you know, and what the possibilities are there. There's some interesting questions that you have to ask.